Escape the winter. Here in the Canary Islands, where the water is warm and the sunshine endures. The resorts are buzzing and the sun seekers keep coming to pursue our shared dream of a home in Fuerteventura. Meet Andrea and Gavin from County Kildare in Ireland, who are looking for a holiday home in Fuerteventura. They'd like their own retreat to enjoy with their two children and share all year round with their extended family. They're particularly fond of two of the main resorts, Coralejo and Coleta de Fusta, having holidayed in both areas recently. The family have invited HomeInFuerteventura.tv along for their adventure in finding their perfect property abroad, which begins with the children in safe hands at home, while mum and dad start their search in Coralejo.
Andrea and Gav, pleasure to have you here on Fuerteventura. You've obviously fallen in love with the place. Is there anything in particular that you fell in love with?
For me, straight away, it was the strip.
Yeah.
The strip. We walked down the strip, I was like, wow, I was not expecting this.
All the bars, restaurants, shops, anything you're looking for, it's there. We still plan to live and work in Ireland. The plan is our kids will still go to school in Ireland, and hopefully during midterm, summers, anytime we can get over, we plan to come over and spend over here.
The nature of your work, is it like something that you can do remotely?
I can work remotely, yeah.
I could probably work remotely, and that's what I'd be aiming to do. It's what I've been doing since COVID.
COVID has brought along this whole new working scheme. Everybody does things different now.
If you come over here and you sort of you get comfortable in a house, you might think, do you know what, let's just move over here.
I don't know if I could do it. We've so much family. I doubt it, but the plan was to always retire to the sun.
Have you kind of got your heart set on a particular area?
Before we came over, we looked at Mirador de las Dunas. We're not set to that place, but it is probably our preference. Yeah. And we have a feeling it's going to be the place that we fall in love with.
Andrea and Gavin have budgeted around 140,000 euros. But will it be enough to tick everything on the wish list for their 20-strong family? Of course, some families often include companions of the furry kind. So just how do you go about getting your beloved pets to this particular patch of paradise? James from Woodside Cargo is ready to show us.
Great to see you again.
Good afternoon. How are you?
I'm great, thank you. Yeah, playing with my new toys. I've got the microphones here, and you've got one too.
A new Ford Custom. Expect to transport animals to Europe and the UK with separate seats so that clients can travel with the animals.
We've got two pets here that are modelling in the facilities for you. Who have we got here?
Okay, well, the Rottweiler is Dude.
Dude the Rottweiler.
Dude the Rottweiler.
He looks very happy in there.
They are, because there's plenty of room in there. It's spacious.
Yeah.
And obviously the air conditioner has been running, and so it's reasonably cool in there, even without the engine on.
Yeah.
All right, and this is Doris.
Brilliant.
Who's a little rescue dog.
Oh.
But she's been with us for many years.
Yeah.
The same as Dude, and they are inseparable.
Oh.
So they're just modelling today, just to show you the space which is available.
Yeah.
And the facilities which are available for us to transport the animals back to mainland Europe and the UK.
And you're transporting a hamster, did I?
This here is for a hamster, which is going back to the UK within the next couple of weeks.
Okay.
I know, everything.
No, that's brilliant, though, that somebody loves a hamster enough to transport it back.
Children.
Oh, right.
I think it's the children.
You don't do goldfish, do you?
No, we don't do goldfish, but we have done a tortoise.
A tortoise, right.
Okay. Right from the UK to here.
Yeah.
So, and his name was Spike.
Spike the tortoise.
Spike the tortoise.
Obviously, you need pet passports and documents.
Yeah. Which is the blue passport, animal passport.
Uh-huh.
We take care of all the necessary documentation to take these animals back to the UK, because we also fly animals as well.
Right.
But this is because the flights are very difficult at the moment.
Yeah.
And the owner has to be reunited within 5 days. They can now travel with us. There is a facility for us to take the owners of the pets with the animals, so that does away with the 5 day rule.
Well, that's great if you're kind of an anxious pet owner who doesn't want to be separated from their dog or their cat. You've got kind of crates for all purposes over here.
We have. We've got a Great Dane cage.
A Great Dane.
Yes, we transported a Great Dane. He obviously couldn't come by air.
There is a size limit on pets that can fly.
Yeah, there is. There is. The plastic crate next door, that's the biggest one that will fit in the aeroplanes that fly from here.
Okay.
But even then, some of the aeroplanes which do fly from here cannot take that Sky Kennel, so they have to go by road, which is where we come in.
The driver's got direct access to the pet, so there's no bulkhead.
No bulkhead or anything, which is why we had it spec'd this way. There's only two seats in the front,
yeah.
So you can walk between the seats and get access to the animals all times.
Okay.
The owner has his own seat, either at the front or in the back with the animal. The drill with cats is almost identical to what it is with the dogs, except in the cat cage that we're using now, you can see the cat as a little house to go in, which is half of a travel box.
Yeah.
But just somewhere for the cat to go in, feel comfortable and secure. There's a cat litter tray there, and then obviously the water there. And we only use bottled water. We never use tap water when we're on our travels, because you don't know the quality of the water you're going to be getting from the garages or the taps.
Yeah.
Where you'll stop. So we only use bottled water and only use the food that the owners give us.
You let the dogs out on a lead.
On a lead, of course.
But with the cats, obviously.
It's very difficult.
Yeah. you just have to keep them inside, do
That's
you?
That's right, which is why we use big cages.
Right.
So there is room for them to walk around in the cage and do their bits and pieces they need to do.
And you can get in there and do the job that everybody loves to do.
Yes.
Which we won't mention.
No.
Great to see you again. Lovely to see your new toy.
Thank you.
And lovely to meet Dude and Doris.
Pleasure to see you again.
With our furry friends all set for Fuerteventura travel, it was time to take myself out for a nice walk off the beaten track. If you know where to look for it, you can find beauty in the most unlikely of places, in every part of our beautiful island.
This is Playa de las Calatillas, and if you've never heard of it, you're in good company, because neither had I until about a year ago. It used to be completely remote, completely out in the wild, but now it has been tamed somewhat. There's a lovely beach here, it's very quiet, apart from the aircraft going past occasionally, but it's just one of those places that people don't normally go, because it hasn't really been advertised that much. It is one of those beaches that doesn't have a lifeguard, so if you're coming here with a family, take great care. If you're with the children, and keep an eye on them, obviously. Here you can get a riptide, which will pull you out if you're not careful. So just use your common sense. Having said that, it's a beautifully relaxed area, so really nice for a day on the beach. Very conveniently, it's round the corner from the supermarket, so you can go to Mercadona, you can go to Lidl and get your picnic, come straight here. You can also do a bit of plane spotting while you're here too. We're just along from Costa Antigua, which itself is just a little bit along from Caleta de Fusta. So we're in between Costa Antigua and El Matorral, where the airport is. It's a bit of a bumpy road to get here, but it's doable. And you've also got a very interesting coastal walk just off of the beach here. So do check it out if you've got time. That is Playa de las Calatillas. It's actually in the municipality of Puerto del Rosario, but it's just next to Costa Antigua.
Time to catch up with Andrea and Gavin, our two holiday home hunters from Ireland. Let's see how far their €140,000 budget might go as they visit Goldacre Estate in Coralico to begin their search.
Hi, we have an appointment with Alex today.
Yeah, hi, welcome. Rodeo parties.
Correct? Yes, that's it,
please.
Yes.
Take a seat in a while.
Thank you so much.
Hi, guys. How you doing? You all right? Nice to see you. Before we get started chatting here, I want to show you the office.
Okay.
Yeah? I'll take you downstairs. This is the pretty part of the office, and then the actual work happens downstairs, you see? So this is where the main administration team works. So you've got Anna, she's our head of administration. She's got all the hard work to do, you see? Our stuff is really fun. And then we've got customer services at the back there. There's Elaine, who you've been speaking to. Yeah. And then the boss sits there in his office. So, yeah. Right, so ideally we're looking at two bedrooms, yeah?
At least.
Okay.
We would love a three bed.
Okay.
Because we have seen the Mirador de las Dunas.
Yeah.
And we kind of fell in love with them on paper.
Okay.
So we know what we can get there for the price that they are. So because we know what we can get there, we're comparing everything we see to that.
Lovely. Makes my job really nice and easy.
Yeah.
What are your must-haves?
Preferably a communal pool close by to like bars and restaurants and walking distance. It doesn't have to be, you know, 5-10 minutes to a town, but it has to be close enough to a few shops, bars, restaurants.
What is walking distance for you guys? Because for me, it's like, you know, from here to the car.
Preferably a nearest town within 30 minutes walking, but 5 minutes in a taxi.
How quick do you guys walk?
I walk faster than she does.
With Mirador, it's about walking distance to the main town. We're probably looking at, you know, around about 40 minutes, I would say. Yeah. But of course, in that area, you've got a couple of little bars, restaurants up there. Are you afraid of doing any work in terms of doing the property arc or anything like that?
Depends on how much it is.
I don't want to have to do any outside work. So, like, ideally, we would love a ground floor apartment or a rooftop terrace.
Yeah.
I don't particularly want a ground floor apartment that I have to start getting patio in and everything like that. So if it's a ground floor, I'd like the patio done. If it's rooftop, you know, to be able to walk in and put down patio furniture and that.
Okay. All right, cool. All right. Well, with Mirador, there is one ground floor available.
Okay.
Okay. Just to be kind of up front, it's not the best. Okay. Right. Basically, it's one of the last units that's there ground floor wise. I did speak to the bank today. There are a couple more coming up. So I've asked her to send me the numbers.
Ground floor or?
Ground floor.
Okay.
Yeah. All the top floor ones have gone. Like,
and we can't see them opening up.
I don't think so. I did ask her. She said no, you know. There are three more ground floors coming up. We probably won't be able to physically have a look inside those tomorrow. So we'll probably have to make another appointment to do that. Okay. But the one that is available, we can have a look inside. Okay? Does need a lot of work.
But even from that, we can get an idea.
Exactly, you know. And then after that, then you've just got the mid-floor ones, you know, which unfortunately haven't got the outside space. Yeah.
We'd still have a look at them.
Yeah.
We'd consider them, yeah.
So what I was thinking of doing is actually kind of picking one of each type.
Yeah.
It's ground floor, mid-floor, and if you wanted to have a look at them, one of the linked houses.
The duplex.
Yeah.
The three bed as well.
The three bed. It's got a garden and it's got a roof terrace, so it gives you both there, you know. But it's a little bit more expensive. It's 148,000.
Well, we said we would stretch the budget if we found... The only reason I would stretch a budget if it's three bed and it has the rooftop terrace. Yeah. They're the only reasons I would stretch the budget. Yeah. It has to tick both of their boxes if I'm going to stretch the budget.
And then obviously the amount of work on top of that.
What we normally do is we'll go up there once, have a look at the three different types. And then if you like one particular type, if there's more of that type, then we'll go there again and actually have a look in each individual unit, you know, because some are better than others, to be honest with you. I've printed off some things that I've tried to keep to that 140,000 mark, just to see what we can get for that. They are in different areas as well.
As long as it has the boxes that we're looking to tick, which is the bars and restaurants close by, the communal pool, we're open to it. We would like to stay away from, like, if there are areas in Fort Ventura that are, like, lower temperatures or extra windy.
Okay.
So areas like that we'd prefer to stay away from because we'd like to be able to come over any time during the year and be able to enjoy it. So I'm not entirely sure about what areas they are.
There's not many of them, to be honest with you. There's not many, like, chilly areas here. I mean, you will get a difference in temperature, for example, from here in Coralejo going up to Villa Verde or La Oliva. It's about 3 degrees difference. Yeah, so if it's, you know, 25 here, you know, it's 22 up the road, you know. So still not bad.
But I prefer the 25.
No, for sure, definitely. The thing at the moment is what we're finding is that there's a lot of sales going on, and property-wise, there's not loads of owners that are putting the property for sale, you know? There's a few. I think a lot of people are waiting to see what the market's doing and everything like that. Obviously, this is one of the duplexes in Mirador de las Dunas.
Yeah.
That could suit really well.
Yeah.
Yeah, we've seen it. I liked it, yeah.
For expectation-wise, the banks aren't taking offers, and it's only because that they're selling so much. You know, it's kind of like, you know, early doors, you might get a couple of grand off here, a couple of grand off there, you know, but now they're just like, literally, I mean, Monica sold about four of these last month amongst all other things, you know. We'll put the good pile there and the not so good pile over there.
Okay.
Right. This is obviously the full availability of Mirador de las Dunas as of today.
Brilliant. It may change tomorrow.
Exactly. This was a different option. Costa Antigua. Have you been there before?
No.
Okay. Obviously, just straight away on paper, you can see value for money is really, really good.
Yeah.
It's got a large communal pool there. You actually get sea views from inside the property as well. It doesn't have a roof terrace, but it's got a balcony and a main terrace. Yeah. And from the terrace, you can see the sea.
Yeah. I'd be interested in Fiona.
Yeah. Because that for me, it's really good value for money. You know, it's you can still fit a sofa bed in the lounge area as well. And of course, literally, just downstairs, you have restaurants, bars, everything like that as well. You know, the area, obviously close to Coletta, you know, it's not too far from Coletta from that point of view. I think it's like one stop in the bus and, you know, driving-wise, you're 5 minutes, if that. And you can walk along like a coastal path from Costantigua to Coletta. That was another option I was thinking about.
Yeah, I'd have a look at it.
It's a bit tight for what we're looking at, but I mean, the fact that it's got two bedrooms and...
It looks nice and it's a good price.
It's a good price.
Yeah. I'd have a look at it, yeah.
Okay, perfect. I'm just going to move that straight over there. No, again, I mean, La Oliva, you know, I was thinking La Oliva, a bit more country. It's got amenities, walking distance, but no communal pool, anything like that.
It's a big thing. We've, like, we've two young kids, so
exactly.
The pool is a must for us.
I've seen this. Mm. I like this. Arigamar. I've seen your video on this one. I liked it, yeah. Value for money. It's exactly. Best
life. For sure, it is. It really is. No, I mean, for the space you get, I mean, they are really good value for money. Again, comes down to location, you know.
Yeah.
It's nice for the kids because you've got a water park there, you know. You have to pay as you go with that water park. How old are the kids, by the way?
9-year-old and 6-year-old.
Okay, so still water park friendly then. Good. If you don't mind being a little bit further out.
Is there like shops, bars, restaurants within walking distance?
No.
Yeah, it's right out there. It's
basic.
It's a drive to anywhere to the nearest town. And it's a small fishing village, isn't it? That's the closest thing around.
Exactly. You've got basically on site there, you have supermarket, mini market, to be fair. There is a bar as part of the hotel, which you can use, you know. There's a restaurant part of the hotel, which you can use as well. Again, just paying as you're using it. The closest village you've got, really, except for Macanicho, is La Jarez. And La Jarez is probably a good 7 minutes in the car.
Not too bad.
4 to 5 kilometres, I think, to get to the top of La Jarez. That's not to get into the centre of La Jarez, you know. So walking distance, it's a long walk. You know, for me, I'd probably say you're probably a good hour and a half walk.
This may be the one, but then when I looked into it, I was like, oh, the area is just a bit too out there. And
with a Regamar, it's always that you would need a car, 100%.
As much as it looks fantastic.
Yeah,
it is.
I don't think the location would be...
You have the duty.
Yeah, I know. If we could just put this in, like, Coraleco, we'd be sorted.
Absolutely, you know. So we get that a lot, obviously. So the closest thing you'll find is probably this Pueblo Canario in part of that area called Tamaragua. But price-wise, you're up at then 230,000 euros, you know. So it's a big, big difference, you know. That's why they are the price they are, you know.
Okay.
Don't worry. And it's such a pity because it was great, but it was
just too far. No. I mean, that's fine. I mean, that's the whole point of today. You know, we start to whittle down things, you know, and then, you know, it just gives us more of a clearer view, you know, at the end of the day. We can use this as scrap paper. When you're looking at buying, I mean, you guys aware of the costs and everything like that on top?
We were kind of told to budget for an extra 10% of costs. Yeah.
Tops, you know, if you're not getting a mortgage, 10% is tops. You know, if you're getting a mortgage, it's a little bit more, you know. But the main things to think about is the purchase tax, so equivalent of stamp duty back home, yeah. That's 6.5%. That's like the bulk of the extra costs on top.
Yeah.
And then everything after that would be lawyers' fees, registration fees, notary fees. If you did decide on a property, all of this we do for you as well. You know, we can introduce the lawyers, we can help you open a bank account. You know, I'm sure Elaine's told you a million times already, you know.
She was great. Elaine was great in France when we spoke to her. She was great.
Yeah, she was good.
Yeah.
We literally look after you every single step of the way.
And apart from the 10% cost, then is like, and then you have obviously your maintenance fees or your property fees. Is there any other kind of fees like that you'd be looking at on a monthly basis? Like
electricity and water is you know, community, like you said. And then, you know, your insurances are going to come out once a year. Yeah, so buildings and contents insurance. And your equivalent of council tax. Yeah, the equivalent of council tax, you know, again, for something like this, I mean, off the top of my head, it's probably going to be about 400 euros a year, if that, you know, so it's not bad.
It's something we wouldn't have been aware of, though, so it's good to know.
They can put you on direct debit and it just kind of comes out without you knowing. Just want to make sure there's enough money in the bank, you know.
Grand, so it's your normal fees that you'd have at home on a property. Yeah.
Not much difference over here, except you're in the sun, you know.
Yeah.
And
perfect. And if the likes of a volcano erupting, if it happened to happen, do you know if the insurance covers that over here, or is this?
I got to be honest, I don't think it does.
No, I don't think so either. It would be our luck that something like that would happen.
Okay, well, what we'll do is we'll send you to the south because I live in the north, right? So we have had people, you know, kind of say, "Oh, we're not sure whether to come out." I'm like, La Palma's 560 kilometres away. It's quite a distance, you know. But yeah, we've not had any rumblings or anything over here. So yes, I mean, really, you know, other than that, obviously you've got a little pack here, a map there. We've got a little guide to buying for you. Again, just pretty much in black and white, just talks about what we've spoken about, costs and everything like that. Team sheet, who we are, who to expect. And then generally what happens next, you know, after deciding on the property. You know, next steps and everything like that from that point of view. Yeah?
Yeah.
Right. So, yeah, so really, from what you guys were saying, I mean, Mirador is going to be probably the place, in my opinion. The difference between 135 and 148 and a half, you do get a lot more with the houses, you know. Not to push you guys up. And these are, I mean, they're awesome value for money. They really are awesome value for money. You know, you get yourself a three-bedroom house, in effect, you know, for under 150,000 euros, you know, which isn't bad at all, really. Bank repossessions always the same, you know. We just, and that's why I said, you know, we'll if you did decide on one of those, then we'll look at all the availability.
So what is the plan for tomorrow?
So if I pick you up at 10:30, is that okay?
Yeah, that's perfect.
Yeah?
Yeah.
So if I pick you up at 10:30, what we'll do is we'll head down to Costa Antigua.
Yeah.
Yeah? Have a look at that. It's going to take us about 40 minutes at the most to get there, yeah. And then we'll make our way back up and have a look at this.
Or even somewhere around Caleta as well, if there's possibly anything there.
So kind of central to Caleta, we would have to drop to kind of a one bedroom. Okay. You know, that's the problem. Up on the mountain.
We don't want to be up on a mountain.
That's the thing.
There's no point in even finishing this sentence.
Because you can get up Chipmunk Mountain and you can be about halfway, which is still nice and easy, you know, up and down. But yeah, the ones at the top, again, ideally you need a car, really, just to go up and down. Yeah?
Yeah.
I mean, questions? Anything?
No, I think we've kind of covered everything there. We're just kind of
ready to rock for tomorrow, that's it. In here, you've got my mobile number as well, so even overnight, if you think of anything, any questions, just fire over on WhatsApp.
That's great. Thanks so much for your help, Alex. Really appreciate it. Thank you.
I'll see you tomorrow.
Thanks. Yeah.
So, Andrea and Gav, your mission starts tomorrow morning in Costa Antigua, which is pretty close to where we live in Caleta de Fusta. You've been there on holiday before, haven't you?
And it's lovely. Yeah. We asked about that as an option, but on our price range, you're looking at only a one-bed apartment.
You've got the path that links Caleta de Fusta and Costa Antigua along the sea with benches, and it's kind of it's a good walk. That so I don't know. Did you do that path at all when you came out here?
No. The whole family, just 21 of us came out here. So it was crazy.
So it wasn't really much of a holiday then, was it?
It was for the kids. There was a lot that was vetoed because it just wasn't reaching the expectations that we have with the communal pool, the walking distance to restaurants. So Mirador de Las Dunas is probably the one place that is ticking all the boxes.
It'd be interesting to see your reactions to different places. So great to see you both. Looking forward to seeing you early tomorrow morning in our neck of the woods down Costa Antigua way. It's lovely to meet you both. You take care and have a great evening.
We will. Thanks so much. Thank you.
So Alex, looks like a good start there.
Yeah, absolutely. Great people, you know. Ran through obviously quite a few options. We ended up with only a couple.
But that's your job, isn't it?
It's obviously, that's why we like to sit down with people before just jumping straight out.
Andrea and Gav, obviously, they had their hearts set on Mirador de Las Dunas. Mm. But the one that they want, or the type of property they want, is gone.
Yeah.
I suppose it's because more and more people are coming over here to buy property.
That's the thing. I mean, we have had loads of people buying over the phone, you know, and it's you know, if you're brave enough to take that jump, then at the end of the day, you do benefit from it because, you know, coming out and waiting,
with the market how it is at the moment, it's things are selling really, really quickly.
It's not like a mad dash for property, but it's sort of...
It's a quick jog, you know?
It's a quick jog, right, yeah. It's a quick jog rather than a mad dash.
Exactly.
For property. But is it a jog that's quickening, do you think? Is it getting faster, is it?
Yeah, definitely.
And I think now in October, you're in for a busy winter.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Are you going to get a holiday at all?
Probably not, to be fair.
You say these properties, the one that Andrea and Gav really wanted. Do you know what kind of people that's gone to? People in a similar situation?
It's been a mix, to be honest with you. I mean, the guys here have sold quite a few of them, you know, and they've sold them to actually a lot of locals, to be fair.
Right.
A lot of locals looking to upgrade, you know, because, I mean, they are big apartments. Mm. You know, I mean, people have generally been in rented accommodation. A lot of locals are getting mortgages and everything like that.
So the mortgage market has started to open up a bit now, has it?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I mean, not just to locals, but to international clients as well.
So, promising news for all prospective homeowners in Fuerteventura, but for our sunseekers from County Kildare, it's far from a done deal. With their preferred choice of apartments completely sold out, the pressure on Alex is rising. Can he rescue Andrea and Gavin's dream? Or are this island-loving mum and dad returning to their family in Ireland empty-handed? Their search for their home in Fuerteventura continues next time.